We are up, and this is the County Connection. It's a program about county government with members of county government. And this evening, we're very fortunate. We have Commissioner Kevin Barnhardt, and he's going to answer my questions or yours, because you have the opportunity to pick up the phone and dial
378-0426.
It's the 378 that I do.
That's okay. That's okay.
0426, that's the last four digits.
378-0426.
And please call, because, you know.
Well, good evening, Jeanne. Good evening, viewers.
I have questions to ask, but there are better ones out there.
Hopefully they're in the house with the air conditioner on. They're watching BCTV at 6:30 on Monday evening.
Yes.
How about that?
And that's what we're doing right now.
Mm-hmm.
BCTV at 6:30 on Monday evening. That's we're going to start with, I have to ask, the work has started on the Penn Street Bridge.
Yes, in earnest it started. Yes.
Any problems with the traffic flow? I know the first night was wonderful, but since
then. You should bring that up.
Yeah.
We had a meeting of the Chamber Transportation Infrastructure Committee and ReadingBridges.net, which is a public-private partnership, as many of you know, through various agencies, as well as the Chamber, the county, the city, a lot of the employers. And it's a marvel, because when the Buttonwood Street Bridge closed 2+ years ago, we thought, where did everybody go? These 18,000 cars a day, where did everybody go? They figured it out. So it seems like enough advance notice, advance press, enough advance publicity that these 36,000 cars have gone somewhere. I don't use the Penn Street Bridge. I now use Buttonwood Street, where I go down the West Shore, the Warren Street bypass in Schuylkill Avenue. But occasionally, as I'm coming through West Reading, I'll take the Penn Street Bridge, and it's not that bad.
Nope.
I truly think that the bulk of the traffic that was getting onto the Penn Street Bridge in the past was coming up the bypass, exiting on that ramp K, which is the one that's closed, as opposed to traffic coming across from West Reading. So apparently they've heeded the warning. They're either taking Lancaster Avenue or going up to North Wyomissing Boulevard.
I would have to ask my friends here whether they have a problem coming in to see me in the morning.
Yes.
Maybe they do, maybe they don't.
But I understand that. Obviously, the Santander Arena, the Performing Arts Center, all those folks are staggering their start and end times. They're encouraging people to come in earlier, stay a little bit longer. Mm. You know, don't rush in there a half an hour before an event or leave right after the event. Just DoubleTree, I think, has put out some extended. When they have events there, like banquets and so forth, they actually have a coffee station and dessert station. They want people to mingle for a little bit and
That's
leave slowly, as opposed to all in one great mass. The Reading Police Department has been out in earnest. The Eric Church concert, which was a sellout at the Santander Arena, Country Western, they did the new traffic pattern. They pushed people up Franklin or Court Street, and also allowed them to go up to 5th and then go across. And they're still tweaking that, because what they're talking about is really engaging with the parking authority to direct people into the right parking garages. And now the latest thing was they're going to try the next sellout is to park people two parking garage, two blocks away, fill them up first, and then fill up the ones a block away, and then fill the ones adjacent to the Santander Arena. So it seems like everyone is on all cylinders. I saw the Peanut Bars ad in the paper yesterday, big ad that says, we're still open. Penn Street Bridge is open, we're still open.
Yeah.
So it's all good. And they're really, really hard at work on that Penn Street Bridge. Yeah. I mean, it's amazing how $42 million goes up in smoke pretty quick.
Yeah, it does.
Yes.
Yes.
And then, of course, there's
a while it'll be really money.
Yes, we saw an actual enhancement of what the proposals are for the West Shore bypass changes. That's going to be somewhere down the road. There's no money for it yet.
No.
But the earliest you could even see any kind of improvements on the bypass is about 2024.
I won't be around.
But we're thinking it's going to be way beyond that.
Yeah.
And even if it would start preliminary design and engineering in 2024, it would take 10 to 12 years.
Yeah.
They're tweaking some designs. They're showing some real actually, we saw this video that showed vehicles and cars moving in and out. Three lanes on both sides, down to 176, and then it goes back into two lanes in either direction. Different turning, everything's going to be a right turn. There's going to be no clover leaves. It's going to be more of a turn into traffic signals. They're going to be putting that out for public discussion over the next few months just to get some ideas. And it's amazing when you go to these various meetings, you think the engineers have it all figured out until a user of the vehicle, of the bypass says, hey, by the way, did you think of this thing? No, we didn't think about that. So it's pretty fascinating. Yeah. But that's way down the road. Right. But obviously it's obsolete. Can't handle the volume of traffic that's there.
In general, because it takes so long to plan and so on and then to build, they're obsolete the day you open them up.
Right, right.
And who knows when they'll be able to do, let's say, Buttonwood Street again in another 50 or 60 years.
50 maybe. Years for rebuild, complete replacement, 100 years. But since it's historical, I guess, who knows with automated cars and the way things are going, who knows if we'll need any kind of transportation in 100 years.
Or we'll be flying in.
Well, just beam me up, Scotty.
Yeah, right? Oh, that. I look forward to that. At any rate, the time frame for the completion of Penn Street?
Fall of 2019.
Okay.
It's about a 2.5 year program.
Right.
Right now, it's two lanes in, one lane out. Front Street's closed under the bridge because Rack is out of school for the summer. And then the last 3 or 4 months of the project, that late summer, early fall of 2019, it'll be one lane in, one lane out. So that, I think, will be crunch time.
Yes.
Especially people leaving the city.
Whether any of this works.
Right. I mean, I leave the city now. I've got two lanes to leave. But when that happens, I'm sure I'm going to be moving up to Buttonwood Street or out to the... Warren Street bypass to get home.
And we do have access, maybe more than we ever thought, and didn't find out until we closed Buttonwood Street, which looked like you lived in that area. It looked like everybody went that way.
Yes.
Nobody touched Penn Avenue. Okay. The downtown businesses, and they've been, you know, in the newspaper explaining how they want people to come in, and you've already told us about that. But what about parking for just, I'm going into the city for just an hour or so?
Parking meters or parking lots is the call of the day. The parking authority regulates the parking meters and then, of course, the parking garages. So places like the Peanut Bar or the Doubletree have parking lots.
Some of them park at the rear of the parking
Panavino, you're right there with a parking lot. Entertainment Square, Goggle Works has a parking lot. So most of those are equipped with parking facilities.
That's known as planning ahead.
Yes.
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 It's something that government seldom seems to do.
Sometimes they get it right.
Well, you know, and once you've had some practice, you're good at it, right?
Yes.
Okay. Now, we have had a drug problem for the last 30 or 35 years, pretty nearly.
Maybe
it's
longer.
It's been there.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
And across the state... it's bad here in Pennsylvania. Maybe I've read some articles that suggest that it's worse in Pennsylvania than almost anywhere else, particularly along the East Coast, and that's hard for me to believe.
Mm-hmm.
As
far as opioids and heroin.
Right.
Yeah.
What are you aware of that the enforcement community is doing to try to catch that and stop it from coming in?
Well, through our district attorney's office and his detectives and the drug enforcement folks from the federal government are working as diligently as they can to try to stop the influx of the drugs coming in. Quite honestly, the majority of it comes in from Mexico. I'm under the understanding that they've converted their fields into poppy fields strictly for heroin consumption as opposed to cocaine or anything else. George Vogel and I, through the Council on Chemical Abuse, are working with a opioids coalition here in Berks County. Numbers about 50 people on the coalition, and we meet every month, and we are really working with treatment, prevention, take-back drug events, all sorts of things to try to combat this issue. And the young lady who's helping us from the University of Pittsburgh, she works with 28 other counties in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. She remarked last Friday that it is generally the opioid heroin epidemic seems to be an East Coast thing right now. That the Western out in Oregon, Washington, is more meth.
Right.
So it seems like eventually that will happen. But the drug of choice, because of its availability and price, is heroin.
Right.
And many of the folks, I think the numbers are close to 70%, were at one time on opioid painkillers and now have been unable to get the opioid painkillers and have converted to mostly the heroin on the street. So you take a $25 pill and now you're getting a $5 bag of heroin. Our chief detective, Mike Gumbar, who works for the county, who worked for the city in the late 70s and 80s, he said back then heroin was more expensive in the 80s than it is today.
Right.
You think about, you know, that's pretty amazing that something is less expensive than it was in the late 70s.
We worked with Zika virus and found ways to, release mosquitoes that will mate and they will be sterile and then we'll that'll go away maybe. But maybe we need some kind of insecticide or an insect that will eat heroin, the poppy plants.
That's true.
It could happen.
That's right. And
it's relatively easy to think about those things. It's hard to get it done. But almost everything in this world has an enemy somewhere.
Right. The piece the scientists worked on was the antidote for the overdose of heroin's which is the Narcan, Naloxone, Vivitrol, that are basically about 30 police departments have it. Most of the ambulance crews have it. The county deputy sheriffs will be having it shortly. We're in a conversation with talking to Children and Youth Services caseworkers with the potential of carrying this on them.
Yeah.
God forbid if they come across somebody who has overdosed, it saves their lives.
Yeah.
And the ones that who end up at the Reading Health System at St. Joe's Medical Center, especially at Reading Health System, we have the warm handoff program there.
Sounds wonderful.
They try to encourage them to get into treatment. Obviously, to have them there in an emergency ward.
Do we have enough treatment centers? No.
That's the whole thing.
Right.
If someone says, yes, I'm willing to go into treatment, it's the availability of beds. So we've got the efforts in place and people understand the crisis and the magnitude of the crisis. But when it comes to the availability of beds, that becomes a critical issue. But
apparently there's
it's very
not
successful.
Enough money in that.
And not enough money in treatment beds.
Right.
Probably why there's not enough.
That's right.
That's right.
It's business.
Mm-hmm.
At any rate, we have some things that we could do, but with this program, I've talked about regionalizing police forces a lot. Would that be...
Since 2009, right?
No, that went down. It just didn't happen. And some of them that regionalized have broken up. But wouldn't that make more sense than what we're doing now with everybody...
Certainly on a county level, the drug enforcement, the drug task force that works through the county detectives certainly is impactful. You have very small police departments with 2, 3, 4 officers and then some to 35, some to 165 like the city. Certainly there is value in working together if there is a drug operation in, say, Muhlenberg Township for everyone to work together, join forces, so it can be contained and eliminated. Yeah. There's been some recent drug arrests, significant ones, through the district attorney's office, and I'll tell you, they're working nonstop to try to combat this scourge, because obviously there's a demand for it.
Oh, yeah.
But also, if you can curtail the supply, you've got to work, bite this off at both ends.
We have to talk about the need to take it away, but we also have people who are entering the... situation and who don't seem to get the word that it's not the fun thing that you think it is.
Right.
And I don't know, we've taught programs at schools going back to Ronald Reagan's and
Just Say No.
Right. Very effective program, right?
Mm-hmm.
I was there part of that.
Were you?
It was simplistic. It sounded good and it didn't answer the problem of why we do those things.
Mm-hmm.
But then we don't really know why some people drink too much alcohol.
Right.
And until we figure that out, we got a problem.
Mm-hmm.
There's another thing. I've been wondering because I've, in reading world news, I noticed that some nations actually have a dedicated police force for something like this. It's state-run.
Okay.
answers to the top level of the country, and it is only concentrated on whatever their problem is, whether it's drugs or smuggling or whatever, to keep that under control. Is it successful? I could find that out.
Oh, really?
But there are such arrangements, and perhaps that's something that we should be looking at. Mm-hmm. Even taking we can't fund our state police right now, but assume we had a separate force that only concentrated on the drug problem.
And I guess it doesn't help that we're neighbors of Mexico, as opposed to being from Norway. Might be a little bit harder to transport the heroin from Mexico to Norway, but as it's a lot easier to get from Mexico to the United States.
Are you advocating a wall?
No, not me. Let's not get into that one tonight. We don't have enough time for the immigration debate. That'll have to be 2 hours of some other reason.
Yeah, at least that. At any rate, the idea that there might be a separate force to which we could turn over these problems so that we can also take care of our streets.
Mm-hmm.
We have other problems with crime aside from taking care of the drug-addicted individuals who commit crimes just to feed their habit.
Mm-hmm.
If they don't have anybody to steal from at home, they're going to steal in the street. No, don't even think about that. Now, the other thing, and the most important thing, and this is what I have not been able to get to, what does it cost? What are we spending on all this? How much does
millions.
The county come
I'm sure
forward
several,
with?
Over the 30 years that you indicated earlier, probably
millions.
Trillions,
I
would think.
Right.
The drug war, and some people say we've been losing.
We're not making any headway.
No, it doesn't seem to be.
Seems to be getting worse.
Mm-hmm.
Now, historically, we've been through these things before, and it was probably over a 20-year span, and it went away. Now, what happened? What changed? Was it economy? Was it a whole, you know, like everybody moved from one place to another? Is that part of the problem mm-hmm. now, that we have too many people, you know, migrating from one place to another and taking their problems with them? Do closed borders work? They never did before. I don't want to get into that. But we're not able at this point to discourage the use because we don't really know what triggers it.
Right.
It isn't just, you know, a kid being offered a... it doesn't quite work that way. We do have some idea that, you know, people who are put on pain medication by a doctor, and who then the doctor says, well, you've had enough, mm-hmm. we can't mm-hmm. do that anymore. That's new, and that's less than 20 years old.
Exactly, right, with the the Oxycontins,
right.
the Percocets.
And,
right.
You know, we had doctors going into a practice to do that. They were pain management people.
Mm-hmm.
I saw one of them. Oh, he turned me down, by the way.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Because I wasn't looking for drugs.
And obviously one of the goals of the medical society, the hospitals, the doctors, is, mm-hmm. is your pain level. You mm-hmm. know, if on a scale of 1 to 10, right. where are you at? So they're trying to keep you at 10 or below, and mm-hmm. there are ways to do that. There's, you know, there's various ways of doing it, but generally it's the painkillers.
And all the rest of us are paying for it over and over and over again. And as you said, probably in the trillions of dollars mm-hmm. without having an answer that works. And again, as I said...
And I think even if you look at the countries that have legalized drugs, and you know, I don't know if it really has nipped it in the bud. Maybe it they make it less criminally criminal offense, but they send people to drug treatment and rehab and mm-hmm. that sort of thing, and they can buy this stuff in the open market, lowers the cost. But has it really solved the addiction problem? It's probably taken that onus that you're being arrested and
right.
incarcerated for being addicted
you're
to
no
drugs, but you're still addicted
criminal.
To drugs.
And
right.
maybe that's one of the things we need to do to not make it a criminal offense to use. That might help. But I think it was Switzerland who did that wholesale, and I've read where it was not exactly the most satisfactory thing to do, and that there were actually some areas where people didn't go unless they were involved in a drug problem.
It's almost like paralleling the tobacco industry, that they eventually had to say, okay, cigarettes are bad for you, so now we have to do public relations ads that say, please don't smoke,
right?
But still manufacturing
of
cigarettes
course.
And telling, by the way, you shouldn't smoke these.
Raise it.
Alcohol label on the side. You shouldn't operate a motor vehicle. You shouldn't be drinking this while you're you shouldn't drink it at all, but they're still manufacturing it.
Right.
So it's interesting.
We're not learning. Maybe we're not supposed to.
Right.
Yeah. At any rate,
we're all imperfect creatures, I guess.
We're still spending the trillions of dollars, and you know, like I said, Should this be responsibility of the commissioners in any way?
To provide programming and monies through the state and federal government and some local money for prevention and treatment, yes, I think
that's part of
the function of local government, as far as mm-hmm. county is, yes. They are our residents. We want to certainly help them as much we can to help them become productive members of society and
that's the
try
issue.
To get them the therapy and the help that they need, sure.
How many terms have you served?
I'm in my third term.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, and being a commissioner, what is there about the commissioner that makes you continue to stay in the field?
I think the variety of the job, the various aspects of whether it's parks, whether it's elections, whether it's the nursing home, the jail system, the agricultural mm-hmm. community, dealing with the courts. It's the variety of the position that really drives me mm-hmm. into work every day and the satisfaction I get from helping to solve problems.
Okay. Do you still bike to work every now and then?
I don't.
You don't?
I don't. I live too far out. It's a little unsafe to come in from South Heidelberg Township to try
to... Yeah, that is a bit. Yeah,
I would probably rack my bike up and maybe go to the Toon Trail and come across Route 10, mm-hmm. but not recently.
Not recently, okay.
No. But anyway, I really enjoy the work. It can be frustrating at times. Government moves slow. Sometimes there's a very good reason why it moves slow, and sometimes it's frustrating because it moves so slow.
That's, for example, the highways and the bridges.
And you wish you had enough money to help everyone, to do everything people ask you to do. Mm-hmm. By the same token, our bulk of the money comes from local tax dollars. So you can only tax people so much. So there's that fine line between how many taxes are enough to satisfy the needs of the community and not to overtax people and force them out of their homes. So
what we really need is an influx of residents.
That would help. Well, actually, industrial growth is really what we're focusing on. That's really where you get the biggest bang for your buck when it comes to tax value, taxable value of properties. Not so much commercial, but industrial.
Right.
We need the manufacturers, the producers.
Well, we have some of that, and
yes,
some more
to
coming
lay stakes
in.
Down here in Berks County, and really would raise our stakes here. I mean, it's a beautiful county, third in the country in ag preservation.
Mm-hmm.
It's great location, reasonable cost of living, household cost of a house is relatively inexpensive, so it's a great place to be. Couple hours in either direction, you're in New York, Philly, Washington, so we've got it all.
Yeah.
Except the train to Philadelphia.
Well, I'm not even going to go into that.
I'd do that for Fred Levering's benefit.
Yeah. So. Are there programs or things Berks could do that might make it a better place to live? If they were, things that you could do?
I just think we continue to focus on the quality of life issues, to continue to embrace and support the ag community, the libraries, open space and parks. And I've said this rhetorically, most homes, their local taxes are anywhere from $500 to $1,000 a year that come to the county.
Mm-hmm.
And 70% of that money gets eaten up in the criminal justice system.
Exactly.
So on a $1,000 tax bill, that $300 goes for open space, parks, recreation, libraries, Reading Area Community College. So we try to balance that quality of life factor with the amount of tax money we take from the local residents.
Okay. You know what? We've run out of time. I have to say
good
night.
That.
See you again soon.
Take care. Thank you.